last week. We are going to immerse ourselves in the book of John's or John's Gospel to see what John has to say about the person of Jesus Christ. So what I'm going to ask us to do today is to shut out all other competing voices and listen closely to John's voice in what he has to say about Jesus Christ. Now you might say to me, Pastor, why is this important? Why should this be important to us? Simple put, what we believe is what we become. I say that again. What we believe is what we will eventually become. Put it another way. Right belief leads to right thinking. Right thinking leads to right living. Right living leads to eternal relationship in Christ Jesus. So what we believe is what we will eventually become. So in fact, this is the main purpose that John had in mind when he set out to write his gospel, which is clearly stated in chapter 20 and verse 31. John writes, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. That is the central purpose of John's gospel, that we may believe. So right belief leads to what? Right thinking. Right thinking leads to what? Right living. Right living leads to what? An eternal life in Christ Jesus. Now, I believe I do have your attention. So let us dive into John's Gospel, beginning at verse 1, chapters 1 through 5. Initially, I was going to take all 18 chapters in the first part of chapter 1, but it's just too much there to digest. So I'm taking the first 5 verses. So in John chapter 1, beginning at verse 1, are you there? We read, or you can follow along on the screen. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. Verse 3. All things, somebody say all things.
All things.
All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. Verse 5. The light shined in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Now, it is quite possible that when John set out to write his gospel, wrote his gospel, he had Mark's gospel in mind. Because in the opening verse of Mark's gospel, it reads, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Mark's gospel has been stated historically to be the first gospel ever to be written. John's gospel was written 70 years after Christ's ascension. So it is very possible that John was familiar with Mark's gospel. Are you with me? So Mark wrote, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. To me, it is like John is saying, Mark told you about Jesus Christ's earthly ministry. But I want to take you a little higher to show you that it did not begin with Mark's, with Jesus Christ's earthly ministry. I want to take you a little higher to show you where it all began. Are you with me?
Yes.
So Mark Genesis chapter 1, beginning at verse 1 through 3. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 reads, "In the beginning, God created the heavens," notice the plural, "the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters." Verse 3. "And God said, let there be light, and there was light." What did God say?
Let there be light.
How did he say? With a word, with a spoken word. God said with his voice, "Let there be light," and there was light. Go back with me, John 1, verse 1. Look, going back to John's gospel. John 1, "In the beginning was" what?
"The word."
"And the word was with." "And the word was
God."
"He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shined in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." Right here in the opening dialogue or prologue of John's gospel, in the first 5 verses, John establishes 6 foundational truths. The first one is this: Christ Jesus always existed. There is never a point in time that Jesus Christ was not in existence. He always exists. John says again, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God." The second foundational truth John points out is that Christ Jesus eternally existed with God. That is to say, Christ Jesus is the revelation of God in human form to humanity. Does that make sense? Christ Jesus is the revelation of God in human form to humanity. Therefore, logically speaking, John says, Jesus Christ is God. Is that correct? According to John, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Does that make sense? So therefore, Jesus Christ is God. John goes on to point out that everything has an existence in him. I want us to think of the universe and the world we live in. Next slide. When we look at the universe, because God spoke it into existence, are you with me? So when God spoke, and he spoke the earth and the universe into existence, he placed in the middle of our solar system the sun. Everything, all 9 planets in our solar system, and we only can see that visible because the universe is a very large space. And what we see is just a glimpse of what Almighty God created. But track with me for a while. The sun, do you know the purpose of the sun?
Provide light. Provide light.
Provide light. What else? Heat. The most important, what the sun does, the sun has a gravitational pull. And it holds everything together in perfect sync. Without the sun, we'll fly off into thin air. Does that make sense? Now think of God when he created this by his awesome power, put everything in its right places and uphold it by his power. If we can liken God to to the Son. He is not the Son, the S-U-N, but He is God. He holds everything together. Does that make sense? When we think of the moon orbits the earth, because when God spoke, He put the sun and He put the moon in place. The moon revolves around the earth. But one interesting thing that as I was studying this, according to the scientific community, because I'm not a scientist, I have to read what a scientist says, and God put that in man's mind to discover what He had created. So the science tells me that the moon, the earth has one moon, and it orbits around the earth. But in that orbit, we never see the dark side of the moon. When we look at the moon light is always facing the earth. I want to say again, putting that in perspective with our God, that God's face is always shining on us. His back is never at any point turned to us. He's always revolving around us, shining His light in our life. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So everything that was made for Him. And the next point that John drives to, all of humanity owes their life to Him. All of humanity owes their life to Him. We are completely dependent on Him for our existence and our survival in our life. You might have heard of Kevin Hart. Not too long ago, I think it was last month or the month before, he was in a very terrible car accident. His car, he and his buddy was driving, cruising. Car flipped over, went down an embankment. Then they had to cut them both out of the car. It was pretty messed up. Well, Kevin Hart, sometime after his surgery, posted on Twitter that oftentimes we think we're in control of our life, but we're not. God is in control. That's what he posted on Twitter. So he had to slow down because he was so busy. And he said, I believe this accident slowed me down so I can think back on my Creator. That our life is not our own. We think that we are in control of our life, but we are not. It can go like that at any time. And we got to recognize we are serving an Almighty God.
Yes.
Does that make sense? So we are completely dependent on Him. And one of the lies that has been spoken of in our culture is people who say, my body is my own and I can do what I want to do with it. No, your body is not our own. It belongs to God in Christ. And that's the truth that John is pointing out. Lastly, where John says, the light shined in the darkness and the darkness has not overcome. John has this unique way in writing as we go through the book of John, when he used light and darkness. Light and darkness is representative of Jesus Christ, and darkness is representative of the sin of humanity. So, last point that John made in his gospel, in the opening prologue, is that humanity can reject Jesus Christ. And as in Bible study, when we were going through John's Gospel, overview of John's Gospel, our sister Jackie said, and I'm going to use her quote, it doesn't stop God from being God. Human being, humanity, has a choice. They can reject the truth of who God says He is. Are you with me? But it doesn't stop Him from being God. He is still God. At the end of the day, He is still God.
Right.
He is still God. Yep. And the darkness of this world will never overcome the light of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The darkness and the evil that we see in this world will never overcome the light of Jesus Christ. Because the reason why we have evil in the world is because humanity reject Jesus Christ. We can reject Christ, but here's what I got to say. Rejection of Christ is self-rejection of one's own life. I say it again. Rejection of Jesus Christ is self-rejection of one's own life. John 3:16 and through 17 is a very familiar passage to most of us. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. But verse 18 is a sobering verse that very rarely look into. Verse 18 means, whosoever believe in Him is not condemned. But whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. I say it again. Rejection of Jesus Christ is self-rejection of one's own life. And that's the foundation, one of the foundational truths that John drives at in the opening statement of his gospel, that Jesus Christ is God, and underlining that, everything holds its existence to Him. And when we reject that truth, we are rejecting life in itself. Does that make sense? Now I'm going to have to stop here, because there's so much to deal with in this passage. But the good news of the gospel is that we do not have to do anything to earn the love of God. We do not have to do anything. That's the good news of the gospel. We don't have to get our life together for God to love us. He did it all for us. He paid our sin debt in full. And all we have to do, as John said, believe and receive. Believe and receive in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross. To me, it's the greatest transaction that I have ever known. That He gave His life to redeem my life. Does that make sense? It is the greatest transaction that I've ever known, is that He took my place and gave me grace that John will speak of further down in his gospel. God became a man in the person of Jesus Christ and exchanged His life so that we may have life in Him. That is so next week, we will look at John's declaration of Jesus Christ through the eyes of John the Baptist. Again, the sixth foundational truth that John established in the beginning of his gospel is that what? Jesus Christ always existed. There is never a point in time that Jesus Christ has ceased to exist. And as the old song says, because He lived, I can face tomorrow. Just because He lives, we serve an awesome God. We serve a God who has no end, but is always